That's where we have failed. I, from the Matatu Owner Association, contributed a camera worth 1.3 million for to nab those who are speeding. That shows what passion we have in reducing road carnage. And a person who speeds, it's of his own volition. It's not, you're not told by the owner to go doing 120, no. And we have even told SACOs to time them, let them report the time they get to the other destination. It's only that we've had a very bad culture, a culture where this business has been a business that you entrust a vehicle worth 5 million to a driver and he chooses what to give you by the end of the day. So what temptation is there? Because there are no accounting machinery that would be able to tell you how many people have come into the vehicle and have paid how much. So they would want to do a trip for themselves and so forth. That's why they could be overspeeding. So with the cashless system, which has actually I've supported so much, and I brought the idea here from Turkey, it's because we have wanted this driver, if we remove money from the vehicle, the biggest enemy is the money in the vehicle. The driver will not overlap, he'll not overspeed, he'll not misbehave. The policeman will not have any reason to ask for money. There will be no money. So he'll enforce the law to the latter. We'll do blow to corrupt practices. We'll have the investor to get his maximum collection for the day.
Oh, you want to respond?
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think there are many issues in the industry. And like Kimutai said, maybe we allowed it to go so low that it will take quite some time to get. The ordinary Matatu operators, or the drivers for that matter, operate on a target system. So I give you my vehicle, I tell you you're on the Dandora route, for example, or Malindi route, and I want 4,000. So I give you the vehicle in the morning, and you work, and you have to bring 4,000. So as a result of that, if you don't, you're not able to meet the targets, I sack you tomorrow, and I bring another person. So whether the business is good or not, what has happened is that the people have to work extra hours, have to break all the laws to be able to meet the target. Then number two, the ordinary driver is on the road about 5 o'clock, even if it's on town service or whatever it is. And then they'll close by around 10 or maybe even 11. How many, before you get to your house, before you rest and all those things. And some of them even work for 5, 6 or even 7 days for the week because they're paid on a per day. So there's nothing monthly. So the more you work, the more you get. So the issue of fatigue and them being under pressure is one issue that we must find a way of dealing with. And that's why you've come up with a monthly thing. And also the issue of the cashless system. The other critical part we need to look at is the issue of use of drugs by the Matatu drivers and their attendants for that matter. And because of this pressure, in fact, I want also to submit that it's true for the long distance drivers. Sometimes when they could not keep awake any longer, even the bus owners would buy them Mira to keep awake as they drive to Mombasa and other places. So again, because of this, so being under too much pressure, some of them are actually on enhancers and drugs to make sure that they can be able to meet that. So I think we are talking of an industry that requires overhaul, and we are not saying they are the only problem. Even other sectors have their own problems. But the specific interest in the PSV is because of the number of people they ferry per day. The heavy truckers will ferry goods, but these are human beings we are talking about. And what we have done, for example, is to try and minimize the use of alcohol. But before long, we have also discovered we may be targeting the people who have drunk in the evening going home. But it's also true that a good number of the people who are operating PSV, some of them could also be taking other drugs or other enhancers while they are carrying passengers. So we'll also bring the operations to during the day and also to target that particular segment of the market. So they're under a lot of pressure to bring money, to work odd hours. And because of the bonus system and the fact that you don't know that you'll have your job, if you don't want it, you walk away and somebody else comes in. So that's why we've insisted SACOs must have drivers on permanent basis. This driver who's there on permanent basis will take care of this bus or Matatu because he knows if it is not there tomorrow, I have no job. So he will tend to have a longer term view of his employment and take care of his passengers. Then number two, we are also going to have a 24-hour customer care number. If you're driving on any one particular route, we've discovered that a lot of times people will talk after the accident. The driver was sleeping, the driver was over speeding, the driver was doing all this. So again, we'll be giving them a number which they can call before the accident, because our focus in the past has been after the accident, what happened? Where were you? What is the driver doing? Was it overloaded? So we want to give these people an opportunity to be able to call at NTSA, the National Transport and Safety Authority, and say you're driving towards Migori or wherever it is, and you're on this bus, it is overloaded, it is over speeding, and that kind of thing. Now, the other thing we would also want to do is that before the journey starts, it's also good for the people to know who their driver is. And that's why part of the Mishuki rule said that the driver must have a clear badge. Because what happens is that the driver will drive up to a certain stage, then one of the young men there will get a squad to drive the rest of the journey. He may not be even a driver for that particular matter. So we want each vehicle has a driver or drivers, assuming it's going on long distance. These drivers are known and are introduced to the passengers before you start the journey, and there is constant communication. And the owner of the vehicle can be able to also get the same information. I also want to submit that some of the, we have two or three bus companies that we've put on that model, where there's a number inside the bus and also outside. So if you're driving and the vehicle overtakes you recklessly, you can be able to report. And also inside, you can also be able to report to the management. And I want to assure you that the efficiency of those few bus companies has improved by over 60%. By just having those controls, where the owner of the bus is in charge, the passenger is also in charge, because previously it was the driver and the turn boy who were running the show. You don't know who the owner is, you have no authority. When they stop by the police roadblock, they're the ones who talk to the police, and there is no way you can be able to report an incident, even when you're sure it is going to come. So this empowerment program, and the Toa Sauti campaign that has been running, where we are asking people, and I also want to salute citizen, because you also have this, the road hog thing. People should not feel that there's nothing they can do when they see things happening the wrong way. And for us, what we're going to do now, because these circles are going to be branded, if it is Company X, it should have its numbers, the management number, the color. So if you see a vehicle misbehaving, you can clearly see, and it will now be able to deal with this. Because the circles are fewer. Across the country, there'll probably be 200 or 300, instead of dealing with an individual. And then for the circles, what we'll also want them to have is to have a supervision mechanism. Don't wait until the policeman tells you that your tire is worn out. You should be able to inspect your vehicles regularly before you embark on a long journey. We have told them to at least subcontract the work of some mechanical or garage companies, so that if you've gone some 600 kilometers and you want to come back, that vehicle may require some little check here and there. Maybe it has some noise here and there. And if you're the driver, you've been driving this vehicle for long, you can know it has a problem. But currently, there exists no such a mechanism.
Mr. Kinyanjui, Mr. Kimutai raised the issue of implementation.
Yes.
And we know those regulations you are creating, they are not going to help the drivers. You are making money for the police.
Mm-hmm.
What are you doing about implementation? That you have the regulations there. The driver, because he wants to make a little money, you put extra passengers.
Yeah.
He passed through a roadblock,
yeah.
Pays the police a little money,
yeah.
And he goes.
Yeah.
Implementation.
I agree. The implementation is a challenge. And I think this is not just specific to road safety. It's in every program you want to have. The implementation is where the issue is. But I think we must also agree. We in this country, we'll always have policemen. What we can do is make the best of them. And that's why the government has come up with a vetting system. And in this vetting system, we are saying, if you know of particular police officers who have been misbehaving, please volunteer the information. So I think what we'll try and do is that ensure that those crooked or rogue policemen are removed. But even away from that, remember we are coming up with an empowering sort of system. Where we are saying, if you're in a bus and this bus is misbehaving, even if they bribe the policemen on the road, you still have a way of sending this information. I also want to remind you that since we brought the alcohol law, initially people said that this is going to be the cash cow for the police. I am sure that is no longer the perception. That has changed. Why has it changed? They will get you, but even as they get you, I want to tell you, your money will not get you anywhere. If it would, we would not have arrested these
people. Is that so?
This
country.
Well, you know, alcohol blow, it happens only in the night, and mostly in the night. And I want to say that if all what we have recommended or what is being implemented would take position, we don't need traffic policemen on the roads.
Yeah.
Traffic policemen are only collecting revenue, period. Drive along Nakuru Nairobi Road. They only stop matatus and they take money openly. They're shamelessly. They're just collecting money, you know, collecting money. Without even checking whether it's passing, no wonder we have terrorists getting anywhere. Because the vehicle could be full of terrorists. The vehicle could be carrying bangi, could be carrying anything. Nobody actually wants to see what is. They are only blinded by that 100 shillings or 50 shillings that they are collecting, they're not adding any value. We as investors in this industry, we cannot follow our vehicles. We could be in Nairobi and the vehicle is going to Mombasa. Who is supposed to look at this? It's a policeman, is our eyes on the road. Apparently they've turned blind eye because of receiving that kitu kidogo. I think it's high time. It's not only matatu operators and matatu workers. We need also a transformation in the traffic department. Otherwise, we'll not achieve what we are talking about. They will turn it into a cash cow and we'll just be enriching them. We know this is very practical and we really know we need to own it as investors. And what the government has to do is to remove these people from the road. They don't add any value. They just collect their cash.
Yeah. Valid arguments, but I would also want to hasten to add. We are now telling you, instead of using that money to bribe, make your car. Make sure you have...